السلام عليكم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. We will continue the discussion of Surah Al-Noor, and today we will discuss a new section, if you like, in the Surah. But I want you to emphasize an important phenomenon that we talk about it at the beginning of the Surah, is that every verse in Quran is a unit of meaning. But think about it as like a minor unit of meaning. While the Surah, the chapter, or I like to call it the construct, you know, we have 114 surahs or constructs in Quran, but each one of them is a major unit of meaning, which means that there is a unity within the surah itself. Now, although you may see different topics discussed in the surah, but it's really the challenge before us is really like to find what is really the common thread that connects the different parts of the surah. Now remember, the focus of the surah is on managing and addressing different social issues and the practices that became prevalent even during the Prophet time, peace be upon him, in Medina. And so there was a huge attempt to disrupt the fabric of the society from within. We always focus on the external challenges that the newly born society was facing. Is that right? And we know about all the conflicts and the battles and all these things, however, with the Meccans or some of the tribes in Medina itself. But really there was a more dangerous threat to the whole society, but now from within. However, it is really through the underground movement that we call an-nifaq or hypocrisy, and they played also a role in disseminating certain practices, social practices, that would really disrupt really the fabric of the society. And in particular, okay, to attack the most clean, chastised members of the society. And Quran will refer to them muhsanat, these decent women that basically are concerned about their own cleanliness in the society, purity in the society. But Quran uses this beautiful term. Remember we said muhsanat is like when from the word ahsana, which means like when you get vaccinated. What is the meaning of vaccine? Why we get to become? Protect you from against anything coming from outside. Okay, but it becomes from this protection comes from inside you. And we said the sanitation of the environment around us will protect us from anything that will, like in diseases, okay, a lot of diseases were controlled in this country and other places in the world just by sanitation. And others were controlled by vaccination, okay? So Quran referring to, as if these are really the mostly vaccinated, the strongest in the society. So there was an attempt from these groups, however they are the hypocrites, the people who have shaky faith, who have spreading rumors. المنافقون والذين في قلوبهم مرض والمرجفون في المدينة. These main groups that Quran described them are, they were behind attacking the mostly protected members of the society. If they succeed, they destroy. It's like the same word we use for a fortress. We call it حصن. Even Quran uses it. لا يقاتلونكم جميعا إلا في قرى محصنة محصنة أو من وراء محصنات محصنة. The same really root, okay, which means that if an army is attacking a fortress, what do? They want really to destroy these protections. And then it becomes easy, like, to invade the city. Is that right? So think about it, okay, in this fashion, that these constituted, these women and men also. Okay, if you start really, like, accusing them of being bad, or they have practicing these repelled type of practices, okay, oh, I saw this woman with that man, I saw that man with that woman, okay. And many times it's just based on suspicion, without really proof. Now, you remember Quran is saying, okay, if you don't have a proof, you will be punished. So that people will think
twice
or three times or 10 times before they say a word about somebody. But really, Quran is really not after, like, vindicating these women. But Quran is after the agenda of the people behind these rumors. What was really the main objective of Hadithat al-Ifk when they accused Aisha radiallahu anha? Think about it. Okay, if the problem was limited to Aisha, it's one person. But imagine what is behind that. It's really like to lose the trust in your own family, in your own society. What would happen to the unity of that society? Will be destroyed. So Quran is really after those who have this agenda. Give you another example so you can understand what exactly I am talking about. You are all familiar when Musa alayhi salam left his people to receive the tablets. So who basically took care of the people? Who was in charge? Harun, his brother, alayhi salam, who is basically a prophet. What happened? Someone by the name As-Samiri, okay, injected a new idea and he brought the calf. With high tech, if you like, okay, to entice the people to make it a new god for them. What would happen? What was really the concern of Harun alayhi salam? If he left these people to become a new camp just because they diverted from the mainstream belief, what will happen? The society will be divided. So the concern, and who will really, like, win? The guy who, the As-Samiri. So Harun immediately understood the agenda. Okay, the agenda is really like to divide the people. So he kept the unity. Even when Musa alayhi salam came, what happened? how come you, what you did that? He said, my job was to keep the unity of the people. خَشِيْتُ أَن تَقُولَ فَرَّخْتَ بَيْنَ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ وَلَمْ تَرْقُبْ قَوْمِي. He continued to tell them what you are doing is wrong. وَأَنَّ رَبَّكُمُ الرَّحْمَانِ He did not say, إِنَّ رَبَّكُمُ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَانِ, because Rahma, as we said last time, is the means, is the tool to bring people together. You see what I mean? Like Rahm, like the womb of our mother, where inside that environment we get integrated into one body and one self. You see, the term is very beautiful. So the quality or the attribute of Allah being Ar-Rahman should really remind us how to practice Rahmah among each other in order to remain one and united. So in this way, basically the agenda of As-Samiri failed. The same thing here. These people who were behind the rumors, behind, I mean, like throwing these clean women with their accusations. Okay, they are not interested in these women. They are interested in dividing and disrupting the fabric of the society. And so the whole idea was, because look at the conditions in order really like to prove, it's very difficult. It's almost impossible to bring like four people like to see something happening. Okay, you see what I mean? It's something that happens in the dark, usually, is that it's not on the street. But the whole idea is, think about it twice. Okay, do not get into this. All right? The society should remain integrated and one, okay, with mercy and trust and all the factors that will keep them bonded together. Make sense? Now, the whole, and so the aim or the agenda of those who were behind these accusations is really to spread Al-Fahisha, to spread these bad social acts that ranges from harassment, including sexual harassment, to prostitution and everything in between. You see, so that is really their agenda. So Quran make it very clear that, and as you remember, we said that this is really the main objective of the surah, is really like to stop the spread of Al-Fahisha and to create at the same time, okay, a layer, a class in the society that will reflect the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in their own hearts, minds, feelings, and behavior. Allahu nuru as-samawati wal-ard. So if you look at these two, on one hand, create this quality type of people, and at the same time, don't allow. So sanitation, create that environment that will not be conducive to these repulsive acts, okay? And at the same time, stop the agenda of those who want to spread that in the society by strengthening the members of the society from inside. Make sense to you now? Yes. So, but now then Quran just talking, start talking about another topic. If you remember, Quran start talking to us about the universe. So what is the
And after that, Quran starts talking about the importance of listening to the Prophet as a leader, as a prophet, but also as a leader of the community. You see, so what is the relationship? So in other words, Quran is telling us that life is one. However, we are talking about social issues, or about nature and the universe, or about really what will make the society stronger, and the importance of the listening to the leadership, okay? Is really what, this is one topic. You see what I mean? They are not, yes, we divide them in order to understand them, but they are really serving the same thing. Is that right? Because the reason I'm saying this, because now the Quran will come back to another issue related to prophecy that we discussed at the beginning, or in at one section of the surah. Why Quran did not put that paragraph in that part? So to tell us that Quran is not linear. Okay, I'm giving you this topic, and we are done with it. Let me talk to you about another topic. No, Quran will mix them in a way to show you that this is a circular thing, or a spiral thing. They are all connected, like we say, you can start at any part on the circle of Wallace. The circle here, like you see, of the blood vessels in our brain, there is a circle of Willis. So there is a common saying that you can start at any point on the circle of Willis, while on a line you have to start from at the beginning, you see, until the end. But on a circle you can start at any, and you can go.
There is no start or the ending.
You see, so the same thing, okay, and it's very common in Quran. We'll be talking about an issue, then goes into that, and then we'll come back and for example, in Surah An-Nisa, you find a big section about inheritance, how to divide the inheritance. And then at the end of the Surah, after it talked about so many topics, Quran will revisit that issue again. At the last couple verses, Quran talks again about how to add another piece to it. It could have been mentioned at that site. But Quran, as Quran describes, كَمَ وَاقِعَ النُّجُومِ like the position, the ayat in Quran is like the positions of the stars. Each in its own orbit, but within the same like scheme. You see what I mean? So with that, we can understand, okay, why Quran now talking about the prophecy in one section, then there was something else talking about it, like the universe, and then coming back to the issue of privacy, okay, to tell us that life is one. Even when Quran talked about the universe, how Quran described it. أَلَمْ تَرَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يُسَبِّحُ لَهُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Everything in this universe is making tasbih to Allah. So tasbih is a universal phenomenon. You see, it applies. What does that tell you? If when you see Quran emphasizes that the whole universe, heaven and earth, and everything on them is making tasbih to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It means that they are following the same plan. There is unity in the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, reflecting His unity. He is one, and everything in His creation speaks for that unity. You see what I mean?
And so this is why you see these universal phenomena mentioned through all Quran. Quran talks about Islam being a universal phenomenon. وَلَهُ أَسْلَمَ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَاللَّهُ. Quran talks about al-wahy, revelation being a universal phenomenon. It's not only revelation to human beings, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the heavens, وَأَوْحَى فِي كُلِّ سَمَاءٍ أَمْرَهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made revelation to the earth. بِأَنَّ رَبَّكَ أَوْحَى لَهَا, about the earth, about the bee. Quran said, وَأَوْحَى رَبُّكَ إِلَى النَّحْلِ. So it is a universal phenomenon. Sujood is a universal phenomenon. وَلِلَّهِ يَسْجُدُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. When you read something like that, what do we do? Ourselves we make sajda. Well, that's to show what? The unity with the universe. To show that we are in harmony with other creations. Yes, in the realm of human beings, this becomes a challenge. You have the choice. You do it or you don't do it. But everything else does it. So as if Quran is saying, why you want to be different from other creations? And it could be that this is what led earlier scientists who were influenced by Quran to look for these universal laws in the universe. Why do you think there was a lot of advances in sciences in the Middle Ages in the Islamic world? What was really behind it? Look at today, if you go to Adler's museum, planetarium. There is a section. I haven't been there for a long time. I don't know if they still have the same. But there is a section where they describe the contribution of the Islamic civilization. That, and in particular, they said how the religion of Islam was really like behind it, was to great extent responsible for this. Because people wanted to know when they have to start their fast. They want to know when is Eid. They want to know what the time for the prayer. They don't, you see? So that was behind why people became interested in astronomy. And with astronomy you need mathematics and you need geography, and, you see? So all other related sciences flourished. So, when Newton described his law about gravity, what did he call it? What did he call it? Newtonian law of gravity? Universal! Universal! It's not mine! Very beautiful, and my dear, there's a lot of symbolism here. Because it is not me. It's not my law. So he absolved himself from it. Okay? So it's really like, it's a universal thing. It's like when Marx, he said, I am not Marxist. This is one of the best sayings to come from a philosopher. In other words, it's not me. It's not my personality that I am asking you to follow. I am bringing an idea. And I am the first one to free myself of it. And on that basis, people start saying, yes. Christ did not call himself a Christian. The people called themselves, the followers of Christ called themselves a Christian, but he did not say, I am Christ. I am Christ. Muhammad said, this is a Muhammadan. It's interesting because we became very sensitive. If somebody comes to you and say, you are a Muhammadan, you say, no, I am not a Muhammadan. I am a Muslim.
to show your relationship with Allah. أسلم وجهه لله. Not to Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. So it has nothing to do with you or me or even Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam. It's not personal. Yes?
Just to add to what you said, why the Muslim were interested in science and things like that. Another thing, it's not only it makes it easy for them, like you see the moon and stuff. But what they thought as a mission, the Quran, if you go throughout the Quran, it really, encourages and recommend and actually said that you have to seek, the creation of the earth and the heavens and, the death and life. And so it is a mission for Muslims to really seek this kind of knowledge. So today we don't understand that
exactly.
way. But it was, they saw that they must do it and they should do it.
Exactly.
It's part of the religion.
Exactly. But really, what I am trying to say here, Muhammad, is that it's even beyond the knowledge itself. What is really the aim of that knowledge? What is really connecting these pieces of knowledge together? So to show also how the unity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reflected on His creation. That there are laws that all the phenomena and the elements of the universe are following. Imagine the sun starts coming up like from different places, like sometimes on the east and sometimes on the west, on the north. It will be very confusing. You see what I mean? So there is this unity in that is reflected in what we call these laws. Okay, that we the more we learn about them, it will make us understand how this universe operates. The same way we learn about the body. And we say, oh, okay. So how do we know this is normal and this is abnormal? You see what I mean? In fact, the more you familiarize yourself with the normal, you will appreciate the abnormal. Is that right? But there is something that is really universal. That we follow as a human in order to know what is really abnormal. And we bring it back to the normal as much as possible. Yes.
Just to add, because this, sometimes we do some kind of interpretation, like it's what the Kahf at the end. If the sea was like ink for the last words. And we try to think about just interpretation of the Quran is so wide.
Mm-hmm.
But actually, it's all sciences of the physical world is so vast. That's also we have to think about that.
Yeah.
Because also cannot lie. It's
exactly.
Being nice itself.
Exactly.
We should always seek knowledge that
exactly. You are the same way we say Quran remains bigger than any interpretation. The universe also remains bigger than any interpretation of it or any reading of it. And this is why you see how science expands. Okay, we always bring the example of Newton and Einstein. See how Einstein brought it into a higher level of understanding without really destroying what Newton basically founded. But he brought it into a higher horizon at a higher level of thinking and understanding. And I am very sure, as Muhammad is saying, that there will be more readings reflecting that the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have no limit. However, in the words in Quran, which means the meanings extracted from Quran, and the same interpretation that you basically extract from the interrogation with the universe. And however you are talking about the universe, or also the consistency that you see in Quran, the consistency of the usage of the vocabulary through Quran speaks for the author is one. The author is one, and it's impossible for a human being to keep track of this. You see, saying these things over 20 years, sometimes you ask yourself, what did I eat yesterday?
You forgot, or what did I say in the last lecture? You cannot repeat. But if it were not for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being the author, then it will be difficult. وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. If it were not coming from Allah, you would have seen a lot of contradictions, differences, discrepancies. You see what I mean? And this is where, so it becomes a way to approach Quran. If I want to understand something that it doesn't really, is not clear to me, I can track its usage in other places that makes it easier for me to understand. You see what I mean? So it becomes a tool in the approach to Quran. If that comes, like the universe, if the universe is not based on certain laws, how I can understand it? How can I approach it? There's no way to approach it. The same thing, we have to reach out to this consistency in Quran in order to help us understand it. Why I am saying also this, where we see that problem in the translation, you see the same word used in Quran translated different ways through Quran. The meanings may be related, but for somebody who doesn't know the Arabic language, who doesn't know the original text, will see that he will not see the consistency. He will not see the concept, how it is really addressed and expressed in Quran. I'm sure we all have come across situations like that, and you say, why the interpreter or the translator used that translation? It should have been translated differently to be consistent with the usage of that word or term throughout Quran. Make sense? So the whole, now Quran will come back to the issue of privacy. If you remember, in the way Quran was presenting a package to treat and manage these social problems, Quran did not only rely on the laws. If you do this, you will be punished in this way. This is one small part of the whole basket, if you like. So there is a basket, a bundle of and the steps to manage and treat these issues in order to keep the cleanliness of the society. People have to respect the privacy of each other. So you do not like go to any home, even if it is your friend's home, and go without really asking for permission or knocking on the door. But this type of privacy Quran now will be tackling is really the privacy inside our own homes. The privacy that we have to, or the boundaries, if you like. I like this term, boundaries. And sometimes these boundaries are underestimated based on how people basically acted in the past, their own cultures, I mean, like, okay. But really, especially and at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there was a lot of anarchy, chaos in the relationship between people. People would go in without asking permission inside the same household. People may not really like knock on doors or ask if somebody is decent or not. Okay, and Quran is talking specifically about times when people, especially in that environment, will take a time like to take off their several layers of cloth, because it is really very, or to rest or to sleep or something like that. We don't sleep in our own life clothes. We usually we become very light. So there is really like a chance to infringe on the decency of people, men and women. Okay, so Quran is saying, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لِيَسْتَأْذِنْكُمُ الَّذِينَ مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ لَمْ يَبْلُغُوا الْحُلُمَ مِنْكُمْ ثَلَاثَ مَرَّاتٍ. Even if you have among your household people that you trust 100%, or even children that have not really reached really puberty, and you will expect, okay, they are fine, okay, they can come. Quran is saying, no. They have to ask for permission. Why to expose even these children, okay, to something that later you will ask them, stop doing it? No, let them understand it from the beginning, that there are boundaries. The same way you teach them how to eat, how to drink, do you allow your kids like to go to the neighbor's house and start eating without, like, I mean, being invited or something? You say, no, they are boundaries. You don't take the toy of that you played with, like, at your friend's house and bring it home. I'm sure we have seen this with our own kids. They play with their toy, they like it, they want to take it back. What do you teach them? That doesn't belong to us. There are boundaries from the beginning.
He's teaching the world from the base, bottom, yeah, foundation.
Because these are habits.
Respect on
exactly.
Each other.
So what are you doing? You are teaching them a new habit. Okay, well, once they do it over and over again, it becomes part of them, second nature. Then you don't have to mention anything. You don't have to keep watching them what they are doing, because they understand that there is something that they cannot really go beyond its really limit. So they understand these boundaries. And so I see in this, I liked the answer of an old friend who passed away, but we were discussing the issue of sexual education. And you know how, especially for people coming from conservative cultures, the moment they hear the word, they become afraid.
Okay.
And they don't want even their kids, to the extent that they take them out of that
class,
okay, because they will be talking about it. But to be honest with you, sexual education starts from even earlier, from when they are even kids, but not to the extent that they later need to understand other things about this fact of life. You see what I mean? Why Quran is emphasizing this? In terms of privacy, talking about those who are really under your own protection at that time when there were really like female slaves or something like that. Or the children themselves. لِيَسْتَأْذِنْكُمْ. They have to take permission. Especially at times when ثَلَاثَ مَرَّةً, at least these three times, مِنْ قَبْلِ صَلَاةِ الْفَجْرِ, before the prayer, because this is when the time for people to come out and put clothes and everything. So before the Fajr prayer, dawn. And حِينَ تَضَعُونَ ثِيَابَكُمْ مِنَ الظَّهِيرَةِ. This is the time when you take off your clothes at the time, in the midday. It's very hot. It's very warm. Okay, so there is more chance for people to become even indecent. And من بعد صلاة العشاء, after عشاء prayer. This is the time when people go to bed. So again, you would expect them not to be like wearing too much, I mean, layers and covering themselves in the same way during the day. So outside these times, so Quran will call them ثلاث عورات لكم. You know what is عورة? It's like when you talk about our private organs, private parts of our body. This is our, so have to be covered. Okay? Quran is saying even, he used that same term for these times. So as if they, this is the time that, as if you are naked. Okay, so they, you have to have some boundaries to protect your decency at the time when, so don't let these children being even exposed to something that they should not be exposed to, even at a younger age, that becomes part of them. We say, for example, in Arabic, we say, "Aib, this is shameful, don't, this is a boundary, don't go beyond them." Is that right? So I don't know what they use in Urdu. Like, okay, this is not acceptable. What do you say? Like, I'm sure there is a word that you use. Okay, say aib, like something shameful. Don't get into it. Okay, so this is a boundary. Okay, you have to knock or say something to get so people will. Do you enter, like, even your own wife, you knock on the door in a certain situation, or even your own daughters, brothers and sisters, the same thing. So from the beginning, okay, the privacy inside the household is as important as the privacy to be protected from the outside also. Okay? So, but you see how Quran will tackle the same issue, but from another perspective. Now from inside the household. لَيْسَ عَلَيْكُمْ وَلَا عَلَيْهِمْ جُنَاحٌ بَعْدَهُمْ طَوَّافُونَ عَلَيْكُمْ بَعْضُكُمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ. At other times, they have the freedom to move around. Okay, because everybody is decent. Okay, so there is no problem. كَذَلِكَ يُبَيِّنُ اللَّهُ لَكُمُ الْآيَةِ. So this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us His signs. Okay, so in other words, now you can ask the question. Okay, it's formulating to us, or you can formulate from this, okay, what type of questions I really have to ask? So we can start asking questions about not only physical boundaries, but today there are also other boundaries. Not only in the physical world, but what about the psychological world? What about the virtual world? You know today how boundaries being broken when it comes to the social media. You see where we have to start asking, yes, Quran is not talking about Facebook, but Quran is saying, talking about the concept. But now you ask yourself, what does it really mean to me today? And the moment you ask, what does it mean? It is an open-ended question. Like Muhammad was saying, there is no limit. Because Allah, يَخْلُقُ اللَّهُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ وَيَخْلُقُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. You don't know what type of inventions we are going to see 10 years from now or 20 years from now. The verse will not die. You see, that verse does not die if you really approach it as an ayah, which means to ask a question. You see what I mean? The ayah will be remain open and alive because it will allow you to ask questions. I read this ayah, what do you mean for me today? With all these new inventions. Yes, the concept is about the privacy. Privacy inside the household. Or how you have to protect your privacy from the outside also. But it's not only physical. Is that right? It's not only virtual, but also psychological. I mean, you are aware of what is going on, like suicide and all these really tragedies that may be related to this infringement on the privacy, on the psychological space, not only at the physical space. Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
I really want to listen also to your input and to your ideas regarding this, because I don't want to see it in a mechanical way. Okay, yes, you have to ask permission, you have to knock on the door. This is easy to understand and easy to apply. It's already being internalized and practiced, okay, generation after generation. It becomes socially embedded in our, but these are new things. We need to start asking the questions. We need to start asking. Yes?
I went the last year in Turkey. My sister is an elementary teacher.
Uh-huh.
And the teacher and family, the parents meeting. I went to, brother, you can come with me. He's one of the parents. You see, they're like 20, all the ladies came over. We started talking about. The teacher asked me, they said, teacher tell everybody, said, please send in here the human.
Who?
Teacher asked all the parents that bring, please send your human this school. They asked, why, what does it mean? When you send the kids over here, they are out of the old, they are, you cannot control it. They need the terbiya. They need the good manner. Because all the idea of that culture, the boys and girls, they don't know they are fifth grade. They try to explore each other. But kids is acting wherever they're home, same acting their school. The teacher said, this kid doesn't know what is the boundary, what is the limit.
Yes, yes.
What is going on in your home?
It's reflected,
yeah, exactly,
on their behavior.
And the home education reflecting the society, teacher gets so hard time to control the kids. I mean, same thing the boundary study at home.
Yeah, I have the same observation. I can see it like you have like a group of kids, okay, and you try sometimes like to treat them with like cookies or candies or something like that, and you see they all start really grabbing. The first thing I ask myself, these kids are not really taught at home how to behave in situations like that, and all came from very wealthy, I mean, families and parents. Why they are behaving in that fashion? You see, why? Because the parents don't know. They have not seen them, how they behave. Probably they have not taken them with them to and eat with them in parties or in the restaurant and to see how they need to behave in front of everybody, and there are really boundaries. Okay, don't take until somebody give you something or treat you with something, but do it in a very respectful way. This is how we were, this is not you,
yeah,
what you have, you were raised.
Yeah.
You don't
look at parents' eyes, you know, and they think, yes. You
exactly.
Know, you can take it,
so
then only
the kids, what they imitate or at least they learn. If they have not learned it at home, where they are going to learn about it? Again, these things are not taught through drills. You cannot make a drill like for, but they have to see examples before them. You see what I mean?
When
take them with you, so that they see how you behave. How you treat people around you, how you eat, how you are really very organized, and how you use the utensils. You don't eat with 10 fingers, you see what I mean? And start grabbing things and not really like paying attention to the people around you. So we take these things for granted, but believe me, they affect the personality and also the way our kids will be viewed later on. In the larger society, the way they dress, the way they eat, the way they drink, the way they treat others, these become very, very important. But they have to start from the beginning. Like as we see in this verse, they have to learn about the privacy. They have to learn about these boundaries when they were very young. And so if I can say it with full confidence, that sexual education starts at a very, very early, from birth, I would say. From birth. Where to have to look, where you have to lower your gaze. This is how children will know. But if I take them to have bath together and say, oh, they are young, what am I doing? Then at one point I tell them, no, you have not to do it. They are confused. But if these practices become habits, they become ingrained, they become part of their, they become their second nature, it becomes easier when they reach the age of puberty. What do they mean, these boundaries? They accept them. Make sense? I will stop here because we have another activity, and inshallah we'll continue with the same. But really bring your examples, your practices, your experiences, okay? Because really this is very important, especially for our own kids, okay? Thank you very much. Exactly.